announcements this morning. First, the altar flowers are given to the glory of God in memory of loved ones by Debbie. Oh, she went back out there. Hunger Action is still looking for breakfast food, so if you're going to be shopping soon, please pick up some breakfast items. You can put them out here in the narthex. Board of Ed will meet on Sunday, the 18th, next Sunday at 7 o'clock over in the hall. So next Sunday, be ready for that. Flea Market will be held November 6th and 7th. And if you're able to help, please plan to stay after worship next Sunday for a short meeting about that. There is a lot of stuff in the basement if you haven't been down there. One room is pretty full, so we have to have the rummage sale. So we are going to plan that for November 6th and 7th. The Neighbors in Need offering is still being collected, and if you don't have an envelope, there are some out in the entryways here, or if you just want to put that in the memo, the check, Neighbors in Need will make sure it gets there. The fall business meeting of the Westmoreland Association is on Sunday, October the 25th at Denmark Manor, United Church of Christ, and the details are out on the bulletin board. That's our annual fall meeting where we sign the budget, all those kinds of things. The meeting will also be available on Facebook and Zoom, that kind of thing. So if you can't make it in person, please send an email. You can send it to me, and I'll make sure that you get the links for that so you can watch that if you can't be there in person. The thought of the week is, whatever you are, be a good one. And that was from Abe Lincoln, so that's a good quote for the week. And I also do want to mention, too, speaking of Denmark Manor, today at 2 o'clock, Reverend Watkins, Vaughn Watkins, who's been here before, is having a blessing of the animals. So if you want to bring your pets out to be blessed, you can do that. We have cats at my house, so I'm going to take maybe a bag of toys or something. I'm not taking any cats. That's a little too difficult. But if you have a pet you'd like to take along, he expects people to be bringing some large animals as well. They have some farmers in his congregation that are going to be bringing ponies and that kind of thing. I don't know what all is going to be. It might look like Noah's Ark till we're done. But it's at 2 o'clock at Denmark Manor. And everything will be outside in the parking lot, so you don't have to worry about masks and all that kind of stuff. It will be outside for that. Are there any other announcements? Yes.
I want to mention that our annual congregation meeting is the 25th of October also. And it will be brief. We have to approve our budget, and we have a slate of nominations for officers, for elders, deacons, and board of Christian education. They're posted in Fellowship Hall. Take a look. But the meeting will be immediately following the church service on the 25th, and it will be brief. So please come out so you can all be part of the budget and nominating process. But it'll be very brief, I promise.
All right. Thank you very much. Anything else? Go ahead.
Discover a fountain of joy, a shelter and strength. Please join me in our prayer of confession. Patient and persistent God, your love for us is everlasting and gentle. We need reminders of your uplifting grace because so often we stumble. We hold on to old patterns even when they weave tension and disagreement. We blindly push our own way and wonder why others lag behind. The short-term good we try to do can create long-term problems. Some days, nothing seems to go right. Lord, let your patient and persistent love hold us tenderly so we may learn to wait for your whisper and follow your pathway. Ease our white-knuckled grip on having to be in charge and take our hand and lead us in the way of peace. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ. Heavenly Father, we thank you for being with us, for being close to us, for guiding us with your presence. We thank you especially for being with us in times of illness and trial. We ask, Lord, that you continue to pour out your spirit of healing over us and upon those of us in need. Lord, we continue to pray for Wayne and for Bill as they are in the hospital recovering from various problems. We ask, Lord, that you touch them with your healing strength. Let them feel your power and your touch. We pray for Judy and Kathy as well and the rest of their families as they take care of them. Lord, we ask that you be with them in their time of struggle. Lord, we give thanks for all the joyful things in our lives, those that seem mundane and those that are extraordinary. We thank you for these things. Lord, we ask that you continue to bless us now and always in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ. who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. They rose early the next day and offered burnt offerings and offerings brought of sacrifices of well-being. And the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to revel. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Go down at once. Your people whom you brought out of the land of Egypt have acted perversely. They have been quick to turn aside from the way that I have commanded them. They have cast for themselves the image of a calf and have worshipped it and sacrificed to it and said, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you out of the land of Egypt.'" The Lord said to Moses, "I have seen this people, how stiff-necked they are. Now let me alone, so that my wrath may burn hot against them, and I may consume them, and of you I will make a great nation." But Moses implored the Lord his God and said, "O Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people, whom you brought out of the land of Egypt with great power and a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, 'It was with evil intent that you brought them out to kill them, to consume them from the earth, from the face of the earth'? Turn from your fierce wrath and change your mind. Do not bring disaster on your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, how you swore to them by your own self, saying to them, 'I will multiply your descendants like the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have promised I will give to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever.' And the Lord changed his mind about the disaster that he planned to bring on his people." In our gospel lesson this morning from Matthew chapter 22. Once more Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again he sent other slaves, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, look, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and fatted calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, mistreated and killed them. The king was enraged, and he sent troops and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his slaves, 'The wedding is ready, but those who invited were not worthy. Go therefore into the main street, and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet. Those slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding robe. And he said to him, "Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?" And the man was speechless. Then the king said to his attendants, "Bind him hand and foot and throw him out into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen." Let us pray. Heavenly Father, may the words of my message be pleasing to you and reflect your will in our lives. Amen. In the past couple of months, I put a lot of weddings on my schedule, and past, before COVID anyway. Back in 2018 and 2019, I was already putting weddings on my schedule for this year. Now, I can say now officially, all the weddings I had for the rest of this year have been postponed or canceled. All of them. I had one wedding in June that we did at Weber Memorial out in the little tiny chapel with just a handful of people there. And that was supposed to be a big wedding, but it became a little tiny wedding because of the change of plans. And I know most of these couples were very disappointed, but they knew the wedding they had planned just wasn't going to happen. They couldn't have a big group gathering at the church. They couldn't have a big group at the social halls. A lot of those places are still closed and unable or unwilling to reopen now for these events. So everybody's been postponing. Just imagine all the effort that it takes for that. It's not uncommon for me to put dates on my schedule over 2 years in advance. I was looking at my calendar yesterday, and I have a wedding, one wedding scheduled for 2022 already. So I know it seems crazy, but I've learned to realize that people need a lot more time to plan than they used to. There's so many details to consider. You have to have the reception. Well, you don't have to, but people think you have to. You have to have the reception, all the catering, bakeries, florists, photographers, videographers, travel plans, all of this kind of stuff. That's a lot of things. If you feel like you need all of these things, then you're going to have to take a lot of time. And I know a lot of the wedding venues, a lot of the halls, social halls and things, they get booked up very quickly. So if you want a certain date, which most couples do, they want a certain date, a certain time of the year, etc., they have to plan early. Then you need to send out invitations. Sometimes before the invitations come out, you have to send a save the date reminder. One of the new things that I appreciate are the couples that send me a magnet that say save the date. So I slap those on the refrigerator. That's just one extra reminder of when this date's coming up. And I think it's amazing how all of these things have grown up over time. And I prefer to have the simpler weddings and ceremonies and so forth. And the older I get, the sillier it all seems to me to spend all the money and time on all these advance plans. But I understand, because I remember what it was like when I was younger, and these things seemed like they were so much more important at the time. For a moment, though, imagine all the time and effort and money spent on a wedding, only to have no one show up on the big day. Can you imagine what that would be like? To plan a wedding for, 200 guests, et cetera, et cetera, and nobody came. Nobody showed up, whether it's COVID or whatever happened, but just people just didn't come. They didn't come. How disappointing and terrible that would be. For just a moment, imagine that your friends and family decided to skip your wedding and reception because they were too busy. Can you imagine that? People say, "Well, I know it's your big day, but I got plans. I got a grocery shop. I got to go to Sam's Club. We're going on vacation." Whatever it is, just any excuse in the world. Just how would that make you feel? Can you imagine anything sadder than an empty reception hall? That would really be devastating to most of us to have all of this plans and all this excitement and everything, and then nothing. No follow-through. No participation. Israel received an invitation from God to leave the bondage of Egypt, to find the promised land. Israel had only to obey and be faithful to God to gather for the celebration of the Exodus. That's what they did. Israel was free. The people were free. They were living as slaves. They were working as slaves in Egypt, and God delivered them their freedom and also promised them a new land that would be their own forever. Remember those miracles in the desert we just had the last couple of weeks? We talked about them. Bread from heaven, meat every day, water from the stones. Don't forget the destruction of Pharaoh's army, the division of the Red Sea. All of these things were done for the Israelites to fulfill God's promise to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. God said he would deliver them and make them a mighty nation, and now it has happened right before their eyes. Moses went up the mountain, and God gave him the commandments. Moses shared them with the people, and before he returned, the people had already strayed from God's party to celebrate on their own. They thought God was gone. God was dead. God wasn't watching them anymore. So they wanted to change. They had lived in Egypt for many generations and had assumed the practice of idol worship. So they asked for an idol. They had said to Aaron, "Make us a god. Make us something to worship, to follow, something that will be with us all the time." And I can certainly see why people would think that way. Because it would be nice to have something right in front of you that you could say, "Well, this is our God. This is what we're going to worship." So Aaron told them enthusiastically, too. He participates in this. And after all the things that Aaron had seen, this kind of surprises me about him. But when given the chance, he jumps right in with the people. He said, "Give me all your gold. Give me your earrings and your gold jewelry, whatever it was." Because remember, the Israelites had plundered the Egyptians before they left. They had plundered the households of their slave masters and taken all the valuable stuff they could carry. So they gave all this gold to Aaron, and Aaron smelted it down, melted it, and then made a mold, and he made a golden calf. Now, why a calf? I don't really know why a calf. That was a common symbol back then. Why they were worshiping that and not a dog, a bird, a lion. I don't know, something that maybe a little more intense. I don't know. I think a bear or something would be better. But no, they picked a calf. But whatever, they picked a calf. So they're worshiping this calf. And they go on to say that this was the God that delivered them from Egypt. Now imagine that. They just made it. You know, just like 20 minutes ago, this thing was just a bunch of gold jewelry. And now they made it into this calf. And now they're saying, "This is our God. This is the God we're going to thank for delivering us from Egypt." Now, can you imagine how the real God would feel about that? How the Lord would feel about that? I'm sure he was slapping himself on the forehead saying, "What's wrong with these people? Where did they come up with this stuff?" Imagine how God felt that way. God was angry, as you can well imagine. There's an old saying, "You dance with the one who brung you to the ball." And that's not what these people were doing. God delivers them and they worship a piece of metal instead. Sometimes we're guilty of that same sin. God has given us all of our blessings and strengthened us through trials, yet we look for other gods. We look for other things to worship in: drugs, alcohol, sex, greed, whatever it is. We trade the Almighty God for the worthless statue. Gold or not, the Israelites' calf was not divine, and it could not replace the real thing. And neither can any of the idols that we have created. We think they can, because sometimes these things make us feel happy for a little while, but they don't last. Anything that you create, that you worship, and somehow you elevate above God will never last. It will never satisfy you for very long. Just imagine the last time you chased after something that you thought was really important, and when you finally got it, it just didn't seem like such a big deal anymore. That's how it was to chase these false idols. The party could have ended there, at the base of the holy mountain. God had every right to smash those wicked people into dust and pick a new nation. But he didn't, for two reasons. One, he had promises to keep. And two, God was merciful. He was, and still is, merciful. God heard the pleas of Moses and spared the remnant of Israel. Moses pleaded for them. Now remember, Moses had a rough time with these people. They had threatened to stone him and drive him away several times. Every time they weren't happy with him, they throw a little tantrum. They want to get rid of him. But he keeps coming back to them. He remains loyal to them, no matter what happens. I know these people are idiots, but please spare them again. Can you just imagine? I could hear Moses sort of saying those words. God, I know how bad these people are. But we made promises to them. You did, and I did. We have to carry them out. For us, the celebration of creation, the gift of life continues. God gathers us in the church. And our invitation is Jesus himself. God has sent the ultimate sign of his will. He wants us to rejoin the party that Adam left so long ago. Jesus tells a parable. He said, a king prepares a wedding banquet for his son, and he sends out his servants to send the invitations to the guests. The king tells them to describe all the lavish preparations they made for the big day, and, you know, tell them about the big feast, all the food they're going to have, and the wine, and everything else. Go out and tell everybody who's invited to get ready and come in for the banquet. We're going to celebrate my son's wedding. The problem occurs when the invited guests ignore the servants, even killed some of them. The king was so enraged, so he invited anyone off the streets. The hall was filled, but the king noticed one man without proper attire. He was promptly ejected from the party. Many are called, few are chosen. And every time I read that, I kind of laugh. It's like, you know, you're just walking down the street, some guy invites you to a party, and you just show up as you are. But everybody else is overdressed or dressed differently. Can you imagine that? Have you ever gone something where you're not dressed appropriately? You're like, oh, I'm wearing shorts and a t-shirt, and this is a black tie event. You know, that's how this guy must have felt. He was going to a wedding, but he didn't bother to get ready for it. He was called, but he wasn't chosen. God is the king who invites his creation to his kingdom. The servants are the prophets and the apostles that God sent to the world to deliver the message. The ones that he tells us that the party started. It's time to go. The chosen people have rejected the invitation of Jesus Christ to come to the kingdom. So God opens the gates for all of humanity. He opens up the party, if you will. Anybody can come. Anybody can participate. Many answer the call by joining the church, professing Christ in God's kingdom. Some have come to the church without the proper spirit, without preparation. Folks want to enjoy the party without helping to clean up and prepare the hall. They're not dressed in the Holy Spirit. They're here, but they're not ready for the party. These folks will be left out of the celebration in God's kingdom. They just won't be there. They won't be ready. God has gone in a lot of trouble to make creation and give us life. He poured his love and his spirit into us, and he continues to do that constantly, every day. He pours his spirit into the world, and he's inviting us to join in, enjoy his love and his fellowship within the church, to be bonded to one another in a powerful and a permanent kind of way. There are times when we tear up and throw away the invitation. Worse yet, there are many who come to the party just to criticize the host and the other guests. Have you ever had a party or something like that where somebody comes in and criticizes, you know, like, oh, food isn't very good, or boy, you picked really cheap wine. How would you feel about somebody like that? You wouldn't be very happy with them. But there are people that do that. They come before God, accept the invitation, or seemingly accept it, and then complain about everything. What do you do with guests like that? Well, you don't invite them back. And if they get really bad or obnoxious, you throw them out. And that's what God has to do as well. What does it mean to be underdressed like the guy that was thrown out of the wedding? When we treat the church like a burden and a hassle, when we refuse to help to spread the message of Christ, when we put in our hour a week and then ignore our responsibilities to God the rest of the time, we're throwing our invitation from God back in his face. And we're saying it's not really important. It's not really a big deal, but it is a big deal because God has planned it. And it's not to suit himself. It's to really bless us. That's the whole point of throwing the party. The king didn't throw the party because he wanted a party. He threw the party to celebrate his son's wedding. And that's what God throws the party for, the wedding between Christ and the church. That's the party that we're invited to every week. Every week we come here to worship, and it's supposed to be like a wedding reception. We don't really think of it that way. We don't celebrate it that way. There's not a big, giant cake and stuff like that. But we are called to celebrate the power of being here. And right now, there's a lot of reasons why a lot still gather together. We gather together on video. It's not the same, maybe. You don't get that same party atmosphere if you're not there. But God still blesses us through our presence and our participation in any way possible. God is ready. He wants us to come to and accept His invitation. We are showing God that we really don't care or comprehend the blessings that we've been given when we don't fulfill our part of the deal, our promises. We have a choice to make. God has offered us a world of blessing and a future in the big heavenly party. We have to accept it. We can accept God's invitation to this paradise by accepting Christ and fully participating and being a part of His church. We can celebrate life every day knowing that God has even better plans for us for tomorrow. But again, the choice is ours. The invitation comes and we have to decide what to do with it. When you get a wedding invitation in the mail, you have to make a decision. Am I going to keep this or throw it away? Am I going to put a magnet on the refrigerator, mark it on the calendar, or am I just going to toss it and ignore it? We have that plan to make. We have that choice to make. So we want to make the right one. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we ask that You be with us and fill us with wisdom and courage as we not only go about worshiping You and only You in a real and true way, and put our idols aside, throw them away, push them out of our lives so that we may worship only You. Lord, we ask that You give us the courage and the wisdom to accept the invitation that You have given to us through Your Son, Jesus Christ. May we all come before Him, to His church, to celebrate His presence and Your mercy in our lives. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, let us bring forth our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
let your gentleness be made known to everyone, and don't worry about anything. The God who created you, the Christ who redeems you,